Today we present Bodhi Butler at Platform 8, Art in Public Spaces, a Symposium, presented in partnership with ICIA and Art Oxygen. Public art occupies a unique position in the art world. Today we attempt to demystify public art practices and preoccupations and understand contemporary trends and challenges in the general and the local context of public art. Can art have a function in the context of the city? If so, what is it? Do moments of exchange between culture and people create spaces for sociability and criticality? Could art and cultural projects in urban spaces, no matter how complex and exhaustive, really facilitate a change in how we approach and confront our everyday spaces and situations? Using the site of Bodhi Butler and some artworks exhibited from there as a reference point, we probe these and many questions. Before we begin, I'd like to invite Deandre D'Souza, co-founder and curator of Art Oxygen, to come up and say a few words in introduction.
Does this engagement trigger our imagination, or does it take us closer to happiness? Does it make us aware of our dreams, desires, failures, or does it simply disturb our visual landscape? Our practice has also been dedicated to creating intersections between art and daily life, so where these binaries start to cross over and entangle with each other, and where the artist, the work, and also the audience start to question everything all the time. And where art is not removed from the everyday, but becomes, but it sort of intrudes upon it. And since this October, some of the images that you have seen are from our ongoing project, which is a part of the Encounters Festival that we call it, which is where we annually ask artists to investigate different aspects that affect the daily life of Mumbai. So whether it's air, water, land. Now this year, in 2016, we called the project Bori Bandar at Platform 8, where we asked artists to interrogate the station's form of function, where it used to act as a storehouse for goods, so where we take the title Bori Bandar, which literally translates into haven for sacks. So we asked artists whether they could transform this space, even temporarily through their interventions, into a kind of incubator or storehouse of ideas, an archive of the city that reflects the diversity or this rich social, cultural, economic, linguistic, religious fabric that visits the station every day. So today we gather experts and practitioners to share their insights and experiences of working in this urban context. And I just put down a few questions before, which are kind of also concerns, but also as a continuation of this discussion that was started last week, where we were focusing on this relationship between the artist, the work, and the audience. Is there any need for public art? Which brings me to the second question of, does the public need art, or does art need the public? I think as cultural practitioners, we need the public. We're always looking for newer context to work, where we can push the work, experiment with the form, invite multiple collaborators, engage with many disciplines. Do we impact the public? Is there any value that we can attach here? In most cases, I think it's actually immeasurable, but the work always affects someone, just the level of the effect will differ. And what do we mean by art in the city? Especially in a context like Mumbai that already has a very strong local culture, and where much of the city's festivals are celebrated on the streets with their own sense of aesthetic. Does this affect or stimulate our interventions in the city? How much of the work is appropriated from the local, and does this allow for a renewed kind of form that brings together elements of the traditional but also retaining its contemporaneity? And finally, does there exist anything such as a local versus global model? I think perhaps the starting point, at least for Art Oxygen, the starting point has always been local. So how a work will connect first to a specific site, a group of people, a neighborhood, but also looking at it from a different perspective in the sense of public policy. So what is the cultural or economic value of such projects or models, not just in terms for leisure or tourism, but also in terms of regenerating spaces, creating a sense of ownership and belonging to a space, activating different kinds of publics, and also generating outcomes which have aesthetic value and meaning. We'll discuss later on the different works that were realized at BT and one of the performances that is currently ongoing right now in the session with the artist this afternoon. And with that, I think we can begin the first segment, which is the need for public art. Welcome to session one, the need for public art. Public art has an agenda and purpose over and above being merely art for art's sake, decried or celebrated, understood or shunned, but never ignored. Public art has garnered attention throughout art history. In this session, our speakers will attempt to demystify public art practices and preoccupations. Our speakers for this session are Farah Siddiqui, our curator and advisor, Ev Lamisel, director of What About Art, and Lina Kejriwal, photographer and installation artist.
They will be in conversation with Reema Gehi, arts journalist for the Mumbai Mirror. A little bit about each before they begin. Farah Siddiqui is a specialist in contemporary art from Southeast Asia, particularly India and Pakistan. With several years of experience as a consultant in modern and contemporary art, Farah has been advising collectors on all aspects of art from the subcontinent. In the last decade, Farah has been the curator of several successful exhibitions in traditional genres of painting and sculpture, in addition to contemporary media on video and photography, and has been involved with fundraising activities for charity. Since 2009, Farah has been associated with global art firm Art Consulting. In addition to working with private collectors, she has worked on unique projects with Forbes India. Current projects include consulting Piramal Art Foundation, Mumbai and NYU, Abu Dhabi, UAE. Farah is a contributor to arts columns in several newspapers, travel and banking publications. She is also often invited for her specialist views on CNBC Asia, ET Now, and Bloomberg India to discuss the current state and outlook of the South Asian art market. Elle Lamassel is a graduate of La Sorbonne in Arts Management and holds a diploma in South Asia Studies from Monaco in Paris. In 2013, she launched the WEA Residency, a not-for-profit arts residency in Mumbai that offers individual studio space, accommodation, professional networking opportunities, and an intellectually stimulating environment for dialogue on visual arts practices for artists and curators. Prior to settling in Mumbai, Ev has run artist residencies in Montreal and Paris for a decade. Since she settled in Mumbai, she has also started What About Art, a first-of-its-kind arts management agency in India. WAA produces ambitious art projects within the growing South Asian art scene. Among recent projects are production of the India-Pakistan Pavilion at the 56th Venice Biennale, the Dhaka Art Summit in Bangladesh, the solo exhibition of William Kentridge in Mumbai, the public art program Art C in Chennai, and she has also been involved in the conservation of important art collections in South Asia. Leena Kejriwal is a photographer and installation artist. Leena has been brand ambassador for Fuji India and an artist in residence in France 2006 and 7. Her work has been published in various publications. Her seminal work, Calcutta, Repossessing the City, was launched as a book and has been a bestseller. Leena's two-part photography installation titled East City for the Birla Academy of Art and Culture has been shown in Delhi, Iran, and Germany. Her work has always reflected her preoccupation with human trafficking and has found a new language in her public artwork, Missing. The Missing Public Art Project uses the public as important stakeholders in the project. The work was launched at the India Art Fair in 2014, and since then, with the aid of a successful crowdfunding campaign, has gathered support and spread awareness on the plight of young girls lost in the dark holes of sex trafficking. Reema Gehi is a journalist with a special interest in art and culture stories. Since 2011, she has been working with the leading Times of India group publication, The Mumbai Mirror. She writes regularly and extensively on the arts and culture scene in Mumbai. She has formerly worked with Hindustan Times as an arts writer and contributed to a variety of publications and websites, including Mumbai Theatre Guide, Open, Hard News, and Varta, an art magazine. She's completed her Master's in Journalism Studies from Cardiff University in the UK. While studying in the UK in 2010, she assisted the communications officer over 8 weeks as part of a work experience program with the National Museum of Wales in Cardiff, and has worked as a press and marketing assistant with the C Venues, a London-based performance arts company. She's also served as a co-director of India's premier youth fest, TESPO in 2008. Here's to a wonderful discussion. Welcome to Prima, and over to you. Welcome to everyone else as well.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for being with us. I think the three of our panelists, and we essentially setting a context to the entire symposium, defining what is public art and essentially its relevance before our other two panels take over. To begin with, you know, I just thought that we'd open this discussion with these three images from Worli Sea Face, which is the prime locality in Bombay. And what I could see and understand from it, that it hardly has any context to the area, or, you know, it's relevant to the area, which is essentially, you know, a prime locality in Bombay where you have so much traction, traffic, and essentially a Kohli community that lived there for many, many years. And, you know, I fail to understand and see what, you know, the art there is trying to say, which leads me to the first question, and I'd like to throw it open to all three of you, is public art conditioned by context, aesthetic, or connections? You know, where you have a major builder supporting this project, or a young politician supporting this project, and, you know, how would you define public art, and what is it conditioned by?
For me, I think what leads, what really works is connection. Because a public art, to be truly effective, has to connect emotionally in some way, be it just to bring a smile on your face, or it to be noticeable. Because I think what's not happening here is that people are not even looking at it. That's what you mean to say. So for me, it's the connection to bring.
Yes, so I think the context is also, of course, very important. And what's interesting is that it really varies, of course, because it varies with the context, in the sense that, for example, I'm part of a public art research group at the University of Shanghai. And in China, and in Shanghai particularly, public art is one of the priorities of the government. So when my Chinese colleagues are defining public art, for them it's art and the artists, the public and the government. So the local authorities are as much part of the process of creating or initiating public art as the artists or as the public, and they put three of them on the same level.
But do they then influence the aesthetic or the subject of real art?
I mean, they don't, and I think that's about the programming. Like the same, somebody influencing a program could happen anywhere, inside a museum or outside in the street. So then it all depends on how the projects are organized and what the selecting committees, etc. And then if committees have criteria which include, you know, that the project has to really take into account the local context, then the projects are relevant.
But I think that what is also penetrating into the sphere of the arts is how we are living ourselves into the 21st century, whereas knowledge is not as important as your connections, it seems to me, whether it's in business or, you know, public art. I think it was Duchamp who said that art requires an audience to make it complete. So in a way that all these factors really lead to, you know, the installations that are present in these kind of spaces, I mean, it is obvious from these particular examples that you pointed out that this is a matter of connections and not some urban planner or designer or some thought that is given to, you know, these monstrosities, which are, you know, in one of the most highly visible public spots of the city. Also, they do not generate any sort of, you're right about the context, but also like, for example, this piece, which is a terrible, terrible copy of Yarni's work, it generates some sort of emotion. But also that leads me to ask, what is good art? What is bad art? And who is to define that? As a practitioner of art, they're also responsible what is good and what is bad, and is that what needs to go out there, you know?
Sure. So is art in a public space same as public art? I mean, if I have to visit, if one has to visit a gallery, he or she is doing that by choice. You ring the bell, you enter the white cube space, and whatever is there for you to witness, you're doing that by choice. But when art is just placed at a public space, you know, whether it's the road, whether it's a traffic signal, whether it's a garden.
So there are both types. So you have art in a public space and you have public art. And art in a public space would be a piece like a statue or something which doesn't even concern the people around them. It's just been put there. And it might not even affect the people around them. So that would in fact be defined as art in a public space. But true public art would actually connect contextually, conceptually, and aesthetically to be truly powerful, to engage the crowd around it in all contexts. Aesthetics, actually, if the aesthetics are not there, it will not connect. If the context is not there, it will not connect. So it's actually
what all the relevance, because you know, you have statues of freedom fighters all over, and you're paying a homage to them, homage to the struggle that they went through, and then, you know, you suddenly, like 50 years later, you wonder, who are these people, you know? I wonder if the next generation even knows, like, of course one knows the Gandhi, but, you know, the other freedom fighters who back in the day may have, you know, constructed these statues, and but then suddenly there is no explanation, and you sort of feel that there is no relevance to.
I think they were mainly public propaganda, the propaganda used by the ruling parties at that time, and then they did something which people have to still have them around. Anything to say to
that? Yeah. No, I mean, that's a good point, and I think sometimes public art is the opposite. It's very often too early and avant-garde. And in lots of contexts, it's actually very controversial because people don't like it, really.
Yeah.
And
we have
a very famous example, which are these columns of Daniel Buren, black and white columns, which were erected in like mid-80s. And that was a full controversy. Nobody liked it. People were trying to stop the construction on site where it was happening, and it was considered
like
as
a
shameful
in a way. Right? Like the Eiffel Tower, in a way.
Yeah.
Probably you also
so
offended by the aesthetics of that.
Yeah.
Right.
And that, I mean, we're coming back to the question of aesthetics, and so I think public art in a way should be seen more in the context and the connection than the aesthetics, anyone can have.
What is the purpose of public art? Does it enable us to live better, to think more?
I think art generally needs to create some sort of feeling, whether it is a visceral feeling or whether it is, you know, like you feel. It has to resonate with the person, right? Who's viewing it or who's interacting with it. I think public art needs not only an artist, but it also needs urban design. And it needs some thought from where it's going to be placed, you know, the context of where it's going to be, rather than, you know, also, you know, you have to look at a city like Mumbai or in India, for example. It's not possible for somebody like Christo, for example, to come and do a project, you know, for example. Or, I mean, mean, if you're talking about relevance of public art in public spaces, you can even talk about cities like New York. I mean, why do they have, or Bilbao, when, you know, Jeff Koons did this big puppy, you know? So, in the sense that, I think that a lot of factors need to go into, you can't just place something like that in such a visible area. And the reaction can be both good and bad. Who is to say what is good or bad, you know? But when it's going to be viewed by over 20 million people, and it's going to be a permanent installation, I think the problem with our city, I have a big project coming up. But the thing is that we need very serious urban planners. We need, you know, a lot of factors that need to first approve before something like this is put up. These are just islands, I think, which are taken up by private builders. Mm-hmm. And they can put whatever they like.
Right. Does art, public art, or art in the public space need to have some kind of social commitment, some kind of social message? I know there's a project that you're involved in, and then of course I would like to ask this question, you know, like you to speak about missing. You know, does it need to have some kind of social commitment or ecological commitment in
your project? So the project that Reema is talking about is something in the making. In fact, we have some good news that we have, you know, the title sponsor on board already, but I do not want to announce the project yet. It is art meeting renewable energy in public spaces. It's going to be a festival over three cities. And it is sort of quite timely because it's talking about something where all of us are affected by the environment and how we can sort of understand the power of renewable energy, but in a playful and a dynamic manner, in a very egalitarian manner, because it's going to be in as public spaces as possible. So in our project, actually, the idea was to have a social sort of impact. Because I think the people who would want to have this impact of renewable energy, they're not necessarily people in this room. It has to be a project which reaches to the lowest common denominator in the city, for example. Also, we want to make it playful and fun and interactive, which is not necessarily something, it's a serious topic. But it needs intervention from artists to make it more engaging to the public. Of course, it's a festival, so it's not a completely temporary in every city. And we hope that it makes an impact on the people who interact with it. It could be also funny for some reason, you know. It doesn't have to be so serious. I think art shouldn't be serious.
What about, I would like you to comment on that,
because I take it to a very serious plane. I don't really have anything more
to add. I think that the question of social relevance of the big art, then I mean, I also have a few slides I can share, but if you would like to speak first.
So for me, actually, because I was talking about an issue which, like Farah says, it needs public engagement, there is no in which way you can actually do a work like that within a closed, confined world space of a gallery or a museum. My project found my space for me because it thrust me out into the public. And before I knew it, I just knew I had to be out. And I kind of traversed the spaces of a public space without the urban planning, which again, Farah mentions, India doesn't have. So though my work talks about the issue of trafficking, especially sexual trafficking of young girls, which has been my burning topic in my really complicated installation that was held in India and in Iran and in Berlin. But from that, I kind of distilled the work and created this public artwork called Missing. I just opened the first image of just the India Art Fair where I had launched it.
So the works were like larger than life silhouettes of young girls set against the sky. It's actually the folder which we just chose just before I made a shortlist file version. It's there, except so it's this larger than life silhouettes of young girls, and they're set against the sky. They're like black holes which have been cut into it. They're like black holes cut out into which millions of girls disappear from the face of the earth. That's my imagery as an artist, a visual metaphor of disappearance. Because the millions of girls which disappear from the earth could but just be sucked by something as humongous as a black hole. They couldn't be, it needs that big a space. So just, if you just keep it to the installation, because this is just showing the public interaction which happened later. So that's the, that's what was launched at the India Art Fair. But like Farah said, there was this, not this whole lag which happens after an artist who's created a work. It got immense coverage, people really appreciated it, but as in India, I was traversing a public space which is really not organized. And I'm an artist who's sitting here. I spoke to Eve at that time, all my angst, I was feeling, how do I install, who, what, where? And there was this whole conversation happening with multiple organizations, public bodies, but I was kind of in very deep seas there. Which kind of led me to have a hiatus after the launch of the India Art Fair. For 6 months, I was in this space because there was a corporate who had promised to take it to Pan India, which didn't happen, which is fine, it's a corporate's prerogative, they can change minds, right? So I was just like waiting to see what happened. And then I actually hit upon this whole huge internet space of crowd of social media. And I said, okay, if I want to start engaging the public after, why shouldn't I start engaging the public before? Which led me to do this whole social media campaign, and I actually said, okay, let's do crowdfunding. I want to engage the crowd further. So I did the whole crowdfunding just so that to engage the crowds to create the first set of installations, which would again go up, and I actually funded for a game, an app, which again I said was a new space. I mean, I was this artist just waiting to see where my public was. It was on the streets, it was on the highway, it was anybody who's traversing the public space, it was the person with a smartphone in his hand or her hand, which led me to create a game which I've just launched at the NASCOM. Actually just got launched in October. And we've actually received the Best Indie Game of the Year award from the NASCOM Developers Forum, which was so huge for us because that's another creative space. But I just hope that make a decent enough game, but they've kind of embraced it. So, but that gives me a whole new gaming community to reach out to through my works. So through this art which I create there, this would further create more artwork, because at the moment it's an exploration of spaces for me, which will lead to more work happening soon. And then this
is expanding your audience.
Yeah, I mean, I've actually gone in a, it's a very unorganized space like Varavi, like this. You're an organized space, you're helping people organize it. An artist is in this really unorganized public space, which in India is very difficult to travel. So I kind of just letting my, like the million hands who want to take up the project, does the stencil project, and it becomes an iconic silhouette now, which people want to take up. Anybody who wants to do it, share it, say it, uses it. So I'm in this real terror of this really huge ocean of people.
If you wanted to say something to me.
Yeah, I mean, I can introduce you if you can have the slide. Two projects which I've selected because they're quite, they're very, two very different approaches of public art, I feel. So one is the Artsy program in Chennai, and it's a public art program in a mall. So the mall is what we call public-private spaces. So it's a privately owned public space, which makes it accessible for curators and for organizers to do projects. It's much easier to get permission to access a private space than a public space. I mean, we haven't spoken about the permission. I think Leandre would be a specialist. Yeah. And the idea behind that was from the owners of the mall, Vijay and Sunita Chararia, who are also philanthropists, to bring within the mall culture art, because people go to shopping malls for, of course, for shopping, for dining, for cinema, and also just to hang out, and it's becoming a meeting point. And that mall is actually in the suburbs of Chennai, so on the way to the airport, so there's absolutely no cultural activity going on. So what we've done is to bring contemporary art to the mall in two ways. One, which is to take iconic pieces of Indian contemporary art and to bring it to Chennai and to show it to the people there. And the other one is the most more focused program on the local context. So inviting also local artists to do projects in the mall and to put the mall as one more platform in Chennai for artists to be able to show their works. So maybe we can slide through the images. So we also have all these programs, and we're trying to reach out to the people in the mall by doing art tours, by doing workshops, by doing artist talks. That's a work of Pablo Bartolomeo, which is in one of the corridors. And these are works of Sunil Gaudin. And what was also interesting, okay, that's the next project, is that the installing the works in the mall is very much related to the architecture. So we've also tried to, for example, there was a work on the escalators by Akash Nihalani in the corridors. So we've been looking also at different areas where the art can be installed. So, and every time I go there, people are taking pictures of the art. I mean, some of the works have become, of course, landmarks inside the mall, like, oh, I'll meet you at the TNT, or I'll meet you at the Ravindra Reddy work. And people are taking pictures all the time, and it's all over social media there. So it's, in that way, I think the interaction is working. But definitely the next step of what we're trying to do is to now educate people and have programs and
Do you have to make an additional effort to engage your audience in a place like a mall, where people are not necessarily viewing the work out of choice, but you know, because the audience there?
So, I mean, the good thing is that people really react to it, but then if we want them to learn from the art, then we have to push and we have to create specific programs.
I think we need to define what is public, you know. I really, really love the project at Maker Max City, for example. Manish Maker is one of the most interesting collectors of the city, because instead of collecting works for his own consumption, he's putting it out there. Now, that is also privately owned land, and it's a gated complex. After all, you know, it's not as public. What is the meaning of public? Is what we are sitting here, is that what's defined as public? Or would you say people in Aram Nagar or so on, that is public? So we need to first define what is public, because I completely agree with all these initiatives which are the malls, because malls are the new parks for sure, you know. This is so obvious. Make the maximum amazing initiative. I just took a group of people from the Vancouver Museum there.
Wouldn't that also be private?
I don't. This is what I'm saying. Who is advising? What is?
You can see from the
what is the? Who is going to? So I really doubt it. Like, for example, when I did the exhibition of Raja Ravi Varma at the Phenomenal Museum, which is open to all, free, I had to like literally beg my chauffeur to go there with his family, because he was intimidated going into a beautiful complex like that and a building, although it says it's open for all. So we need to define what is public, you know. I think I'm completely for these private initiatives, but I don't know how public is this in a public-private. The other thing I wanted to sort of discuss is, you know, that of course, we mostly international. nationally, it's these public art projects are supported by the governments, and we don't have that. So that's why the lack of that, all the collectors, for example, we don't have private museums, so our collectors and our gallerists, they take up these roles, which are amazing, and the things that they do, for example, are just fabulous, including something like this.
Yeah, I think it's a first step.
Yeah.
I think it's amazing that we can today access these private public spaces.
Yeah.
It is, of course, some of them are more open and have like a more like a wider crowd than others.
Yeah. For example, the Start project, which is fabulous.
The street art.
The street art project. I think that is a completely like commendable what they have done. Because this is as public as it gets. You cannot ignore it. You see Dada Saheb Phalke at Bandra whenever you're crossing that area, or now in Hyderabad, or in Delhi.
Filthy Lookers were coming out of the Jinnah Mansion at Penny Road, and people used to like stop their cars, school buses used to be there, you know, screaming it's an alien, or you could think whatever it was, and the night it was launched, there was a major traffic at Penny Road. And you know, so much so people thought that there's something happening there, and our reporters were alerted, and then they came to know it's this art project that's being launched. So I mean, who is your audience when it's a public?
Exactly.
When
what is art? First of all, you have to define which public are you.
Exactly. But who is your audience when you have art in a public space?
Everyone. Mm-hmm. It has to be everyone. It has to be from a 3-year-old child to a 90-year-old grandmother. It has to be anybody who crosses that path or goes through it. I mean, I am from all strata. It has to be egalitarian. It has to be democratic. This is what I think. For me, that's what's the meaning of public art. You know, I don't define public by, the well-dressed people who go into a museum or who can afford to buy a ticket to go into a museum, you know, for example. With our staff at home, we interact a lot. And I tried to get Krishofer to come. He used to see me going there for 6 months trying to do the show and working all night to install it and all of that. And he still was intimidated to walk into the complex with his family, considering he's been with me throughout. I mean, he was my real partner in the project, because I would come back in the car and abuse everyone I worked with. Right? So he knew exactly what's going on. But instead of, like, he was intimidated. So I really think that my chauffeur, for example, who's really my key audience in a way, is not going to walk into a Phoenix mall. You know? Although I think what they're doing for that audience is wonderful. You know? I don't think he's going to go to make a Max City.
Sure.
Although personally, I think what Manish is doing is extraordinary.
He's
because he's
commercial.
Yeah, he's doing it for the people who interact with, who are in that complex, who are of a certain strata, educated. Who also have no art education.
Sure.
They're all well-dressed MBAs who work with BNP Paribas, some land, which is in that complex, and who can go to a LBQ for a coffee.
Yeah.
But, that for me, public art is a project which is completely democratic. This is very clear in my mind.
Lina, did you know who your audience was when you put that missing project out there, talking about a global issue of missing girls and human trafficking?
I mean, exactly that. For me, my public is that it's for everyone, that from a 3 to 19-year-old. So that itself just leads you way out beyond any walls and boundaries. And actually, that's why I'm looking at the sky as my canvas, because the sky is universal. Anybody and everybody's going to look at the sky. So for me, as an artist, because we are here, we can dream, right? We can dream any space, and I say, that's my space. And it leads me to create a piece which fit beautifully, and I just want to be there. And I think the sky is still very, very, is not going to be so difficult for me to find across the cities of India. And I'm still hopeful to tie up with the right people. But that's what happened. I mean, for me, it's everyone.
And traversing through all these online and offline mediums is also another new space for me, because I think we cannot ignore the internet. We cannot ignore, and I'm delightfully going to explore the gamers section of the audience. And these huge installations across the sky, I mean, that's my audience. It's anybody and everybody. Anybody who gets hit, I mean, nobody has seen a silhouette and says, it's left people hollow. It's left people, I mean, they literally had to take away. And then I've had, of course, people saying it's very Bansky-ish at the very beginning when the silhouette started appearing in Calcutta. And at that time, we didn't have the hashtag to it. You know, it's all these things which are developed. So someone says, how would people know about your campaign? So I said, okay, let's do a hashtag. So you started doing a hashtag with a single, so the one G, you know, one unique G. Then someone else says, you know, some activists who actually want to make a difference, you say, but Lina's still not helping enough. So I said, what else do you think I can do? They said, then I came across this really unique, lovely number which India now has, 1098, Childline Health Number. So I said, fine, let's use that. So now my missing stencil has a hashtag, has a number, and I'm just ready to do, I'm just going with the flow. And then some places we do have stencils, some places we have children or whoever, the road tractors in Bombay have been busy painting about 100 stencils around Bombay, I believe. But I think they have busily spray canned hashtag single and the number. It's not neat anymore.
Can public art facilitate change?
Yes, it will. It does. Yeah. Because see, till something which I want to see as an artist, which I think deserves to be mentioned, that's what's driving me as an artist. There's different things which is driving other artists. For me, this is my driving force. So if this, I believe, if this issue, what I'm trying to say, is something so universal, if this cannot become a part of the social fabric, the social thought, it will not become a part of a legal or a legal campaign. Because everyone's too busy otherwise to do other things. So there's a whole collective not saying, yes, this has to be addressed, you know, or let's not be a part of it. It's not, you know, I mean, it'll help. I'm not saying it's going to be instrumental, but it'll help.
Right. Would you two like to add to what Lina has to say?
On this question of change, maybe we can look at the next example I have, but it's more constrained to a, I mean, it's a very specific context, so that way the audience is less wide than the 3 years old to 95 years old person. But sorry, the images are not so good, but basically it's in Japan, and it's a site with like settlements for people who have been in the tsunami and earthquakes, so it's like thousands of people who are suddenly forced to go and live there, and that's absolutely nothing. And from, I mean, the life in the city that they had, with all the activities, they just go there, and you know, there's nothing to do. So the artist comes to the, his name is Yun Kitata, and he started working with the people there, and the creative process. I mean, they are part of the creative process. So it's looking at this place where they're gonna have to live for a couple of months, maybe a couple of years. They don't know how long they're gonna be there. And then decided together, what can we do to beautify the space? What can we do to make the space more livable? To create activities, to generate, you know, social links also between all these people. So the artist is slowly then. I mean, we've seen one girl is waving with plastic. So they start by putting, like, creating a place, creating like a public place where they cannot meet, so they're putting these carpets on the floor, and that's becoming every day just a symbolic space where everybody can meet and start interacting, then cooking together, then creating these markets, etc. And then thanks to the artist coming in the community and starting working with them, then the project unfolds and obviously creates social change for that particular community. So I picked that up to also show that public art can be something very different from a sculpture on a roundabout. You know, sometimes it's not about the form and the aesthetics, but it's about the process.
What about the language of public art? You know, you have, you know, the Ajanta and Ellora caves, you know, where you have these decorative sculptures trying to tell you something, or you have a project like this. What is essentially, you know, your medium of communication?
Or you have you come across this massive, massive parade ground, or I don't know how what you can call it. You can't call it a park. It's so massive with these amazing, So, oh, sorry, what was your question? What is the language of park? I'm so mesmerized.
Could you talk a little about that in your experience?
Well, I thought they were very interesting. Honestly, I don't think that they were badly done. And I think for that audience, it was interesting. I believe in Lucknow also, they have a lot of the... I think what she's done is activated public spaces by beautifying existing parks. Of course, she had to take ownership of it, so hence the sculptures, which are life-size with a handbag on the side, very cute. So what the question was about language of public art. I don't think that there should be, you can't define. You have to, as art, you have to first of all break all boundaries.
Sure.
So what is art, actually, again? Is it the these elephant sculptures that in Uttar Pradesh, or is it a playful sort of thing that Air has sort of like very interesting?
I think about statues, the campaign which happened with the Trump statue, the building all over. I mean, that's what statues did also. And it, I mean, that's I think one of the terrific things what statues could do.
Also, they have these Thanksgiving parade, I think, in New York, and these huge floats. So is that also a public art intervention? It could generate any reaction, you know, it could be fun for a child, but it could be
tradition.
Yeah, it could be tradition. So all these amazing red steps, which are in New York, isn't it? Which are sort of a take on the Spanish steps in Rome. So I think anything that activates or ignites some curiosity in the mind of the public is really the language. And it could be a pavilion design, you know. It could be a very interesting bus stop also. You know, anything which evokes some sort of a response could be the language. I think we should first of all break all these boundaries of what is what, you know. It's very important.
And how as artists, I mean, have you worked with several artists across countries, you know, who've intervened in public spaces? You know, is there a set method or rule that they must approach, you know, when they are making these interventions in public spaces?
I mean, not really. Apart that, in certain countries and certain contexts, we have norms. So public art can become actually very technically challenging if you're looking at, for example, putting up a permanent installation in the public space, and then artists have to work with engineers and architects, and you know, make sure that the work is respecting the norms of public safety, etc. And that's why also I think today there are lots of temporary projects as well. I don't want to say easier, but you know, which can be implemented with less budgets and with less norms.
You also have to, you know, tackle issues of security, density,
I spoke with one curator who's curating the Folkestone Triennale, that's in the UK. And when he was visiting artist studios before the Triennale, he used to go with a baseball bat. And he was telling the artist, I should be able to bag your work right now and make sure it doesn't fall or break or, you know. So definitely safety and, strength of our working and vandalism is something they have to take into account.
Right. Should we open this discussion to the audience and include anyone who has questions?
can you talk about the airport, the Bombay airport? And that's one thing which none of you have talked about. And you know, we talk about public art, we talk about visual art, what about performing art? What about like a flash mob? Like I, you know, in Grand Central, I used to see that happen every week. Like what has happened in BT, we talk about that. You also talk about that as a form of public art.
Well, I think the airports falls in the same category as Make a Man City or Art City, which is the person has to buy a ticket, right? You can't really just go into the airport without having an agenda to be there. So I think these are fantastic, for me, I think these are fantastic initiatives. And if these are like, we are actually starting from ground zero, right, in India, for everything. But I would say they're public-private partnerships. I think that's, they're not as public as a public art project should be. For me, I think start, I do not know them at all, but I think they're just fabulous. I think that is as public as you can get. So,
I mean, on the airport, but you know what? I've asked so many people, did you see that piece of artwork? They did not even know it existed. And then you're going past the escalator and, you're rubbing your nose against it over here. And I'm like, wow. But there are so many others around me who are so oblivious to that.
I think the role of the airport art project is also that it's a by the way thing, you know, and it's a liminal space.
It's beautiful for us to watch it, but I think there's so many more who are totally, totally oblivious to what they have around them.
Yeah, and maybe it's the lack of, I mean, that's not much information one can get. My thesis also, I mean, that's not that you get an app or something, or you're waiting.
I think every 5 flights you might stop. Like I have a flight now, actually, so I must run. But I'm usually run just jetting across, running through the terminal. So, but yeah, I mean it's a surprise. It's a surprise.
It's so much.
It's also a gateway to Bombay, like you know, Rajiv Sethi likes to call it. You know. So.
So I have a question for Swasini. Swasini, just looking at, I've been following your project for a while. Sorry, Lina. So, no, I just happened to see Swasini's work just yesterday, so then, sorry. I've asked you this question earlier too on Facebook. Really, is the project about the missing girls, or is it about you as an artist kind of intervening? The fact that the strata from where the girls go missing would not even know what a hashtag is, or whether we're talking about gaming. It's a very, very serious subject. Yes. So as an artist, what is your ethical responsibility to appropriate something from a context that is a social context, and then use it to also further your own practice as an artist? You know, it's the ethics of public art are extremely, extremely fragile. And what is that thin boundary, you know? Is this something you've thought of?
No, I mean, this is all what I think about. So it's all consuming for me. And I think it's both, whatever you mentioned. It is an issue which has to be faced by all of us. And as well as it is me as an artist who wants to only talk about that issue. So I'm saying yes to both. So, but I'm not in any way trying to play on that, because there's a lot of work going on. It's been an exploration, like what I was telling Farah before I started talking. This project is an ongoing exploration of what I'm seeing, feeling, hearing, experiencing, because there's a lot of ground level work which I am also a part of, because I think that's my what I would say, my sincerity to my topic, because till I've not dug in deep to the issue, I don't think I would have been able to reach so far. I mean, and I have been consistently working on this for the last 5 years or more. So I don't think my interests would have lied so long in a topic which I think was just the flavor of the day for me. So I'm totally, I understand where you're coming from, but I can say in a very proud manner, no, there's much more here. And talking about the hashtags, see, because I'm using the social media as a very important part of the engagement, though the crowd on the street or the wall where we have made that hashtag, they might not know more about it, but it's all the others who are seeing the hashtag on social media who can connect to the bigger project. like I was saying, I'm using the online and the offline spaces. So for me, it's very important to connect them. So the gaming community itself is huge. I mean, see, I can really talk a lot about the issue, but I don't think out here the audience wants to know about the issue of human trafficking, which I've actually now started to speak on. I spoke with Imrana in the USAID because I've actually now been told to speak on gender issues and technology. How I'm using technology to make a change in gender issues. I was flabbergasted. I was actually called to speak there. And I think I did make a mark there. I mean, a lot of people understood what I was saying. So it's really like me digging deep in this. I'm in this for a long haul. It's not for me the flavor of the day or my flavor of the year or the decade, I would say. It's already been a decade since I've been working on the issue. So I think that's my call as an artist. I think every artist has their call and every artist has their topic which they discuss and they show. And this is it for me. And the gaming community is huge as an audience whom I want to talk to, because demand creates supply. I just touch a little bit more because you've asked me this thing. See, why have I gone to public art? Because trafficking is demand driven. And this is an issue which I've been now experiencing with lots of my good friends who've been working in NGOs like Ruchira Gupta, Urmi Basu, all people who've been working on trafficking. And we've realized, like, though the NGOs and all are working really deep on the issue, it's the public outside, like you and me, artists, and the people who walk on the streets who think this is not their topic. But we are the ones who are driving it. We are the demand makers. Trafficking is supply of the demand curve. Where is the demand, there will be a supply. So when I'm talking to a populace and I'm saying, hey, we can't ignore this topic if we all are a part of it. And that's when I start telling everybody, you can be an abolitionist by putting up the stencil where you want. You can say cry demand abolishment. I mean, I'm making all these cries on hashtags and demand and trafficking, because that's what drives people to understand the issue. And that's why I want to talk to the gaming community, because they are a very big demand makers of the issue of trafficking. And not everybody is addressing it because it's still not top agenda on political issues. It's not top agenda for a lot of people. I can go on, but I won't.
So we have room for one more question here.
I just wanted to ask you, Lina, the villages that you visited, were they places where girls have
Yes,
gone
so I. You won't believe that I've had this opportunity to save 50 girls.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's happening. I want more. I want more people to be here. I mean, just because I seem to know more about the issue than most people know, I'm able to help, connect. Police people have told me, Chala, do you want to help us? So someone's 18-year-old, she turned 18, and then she goes to takes her ATM card, and she runs from home. This person says, my manager's daughter's run from home. I said, call Childline. Girl's childline, but she's over 18. I pick up the phone and I'm going to talk to a policeman. He says, just send all these details to me. I'm sending it to that person who's concerned. Blah, blah, blah. Three stops, three phone calls. They managed to reach her in Mohali, in Punjab. Apparently, 3 days she'd gone from West Bengal to Punjab and she was going to be trafficked to the Middle East. And the girl didn't know next day. I mean, 1 week, it's a very deep issue. And I'm deeply entrenched into it. I don't want to talk more. But it's really huge and I'm just very driven by it. Like I said, I'm just exploring the space and I'm able to get the game to also win the NASCOM Game Developers Forum. It gives me a whole new community to talk through the work. And it's going to build to much more art. I can see it. Though it's really issue-based just now, there is a lot of art happening alongside. And so I continue to be an artist first and then an activist.
My name is Vala, and I'm one of those that group of people whom Farah offhandedly referred to as MDAs who were very well dressed. I'm not an MDA. I am an MDA, but I'm not particularly well dressed. So maybe I can exclude myself from that category. I should live in that same area, Gwali, which you showed so many times in this presentation. And one thing I want to mention is that. You know, when you say that art in public places, there are places which are public, but that's not where the public is. Okay. Now, for example, that Gwali Seat is a public place. This area, not here, maybe Taj Lobby is a public place, Jamir Art Gallery is a public place, Maidan, Old Maidan is a public place, but there's no public there. Okay, you have access, but really nobody's there. The place where the public is where I think you should focus on in terms of the art. But I don't see even a mention of that. Other things are happening there. Now, for example, you may know that in all the railway stations now, and the one closest to me is Mahalakshmi railway station, they are undergoing transformation through art. Now, in the Mahalakshmi station, for example, there are giant paintings which have been put up, all by students, all working free of cost, showing the Mahalakshmi temple, showing the race course, showing the dhobi ghat, all there in just that one station. Okay, maybe these things are happening all over the place, I don't know, but this particular station, I do know. So I think that's where the public is. Okay, other places maybe heritage public or nobody's like.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mentioned earlier, that we need to define what is public. You know, that is incredibly important. And I think all of us have different definitions of what public means. I know exactly what public means for me. It has to be extremely democratic, it has to reach every single person. So I think everybody is making their own initiatives, and you know, everybody is doing a great job with what they are bringing to the table. I mean, private collectors are just doing phenomenal things. They have to replace, ideas of museum. I think malls are the new museum as well. It's fantastic. I mean, of course they are. They're the new public park. For example, the mall in Delhi, the DLF mall, Emporio, whatever it's called. You have 50,000 people going to a mall a day. Is it a joke? It's not. But these people are not well informed about art. They don't have art education. And that is also another issue that we have. And I think it's fantastic. So that kind of community interacts with art at that level. And the kind of community I want to reach out to with my public intervention will be every single person. I mean, 20 million people in the city. This is, it's going to be spread over 7 spaces. It's going to be artists, it's going to be design people, and also students. So we're trying to give an opportunity to everyone.
And
I will, yeah, assert very kindly, of course, you have to, you may.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Farah, Dina, and Air. We had a very fruitful discussion this morning, and we hand the mic over.